Good day, and welcome to my presentation. I will be doing my presentation today on the Musa bulbosiana, otherwise known as the wild banana or plantain. My name is Tamil Sotirio Naika, so sit back and relax as we speak about the wild banana. So how I will structure this presentation is I will first give an introduction as to what is a niche model, what the purpose is of this assignment, the research objectives, facts about the wild banana, the methods that I use, and my interpretations. So, let's start with an introduction. What exactly is a niche model? This is a diagram of an ecological niche model, which represents the place or function of an organism within its ecosystem, which in this case is determined by two variables, temperature and moisture. A niche model is an ecological construct defining the optimum environment for growth, reproduction, and survival of a species. Niches are defined by three main factors: substrate, microclimate, and competition. Ecological niche modeling predicts the distribution of species in geographic space. So, the purpose of this assignment. Well, the central point of this assignment is to investigate how we can optimize food crop species selected within the operating environment conditions. One of my approaches would be to use an ecological niche model to investigate future suitable conditions for my crop species, the Musa bulbosiana. For this assignment, I will concentrate on food plants as they are easier to model and fewer complicating variables to assess under their current climate and predicted future climate. It needs to be recognized that food is often grown in areas where the crop food species would not naturally occur due to climate and other limitations. As a result, food production has become highly dependent on the use of irrigation, fertilizer, pesticides, and artificially heated environments. These methods have increased the ecological footprint of commercial crop production and has led to some extreme global climate changes. So, what is the wild banana? Well, it is commonly known as the plantain. The Musa bulbosiana is a wild type of banana species native to South Asia, northern Southeast Asia, and southern China. It is one of the ancestors of the modern cultivated bananas, along with Musa acuminata. It produces a large clump of pseudostems, and they grow up on perennial sterniferous, a horizontal branch made from the base of a plant that produces new plants from buds at its tips or nodes, and it is also the parent crop of the cultivated banana. So, the uses for this banana is that it has fruit and medicinal uses, but the seeds often make these bananas inedible. So, you'll find that they are often fried, as shown in the picture above. And it is also a native dish to South America. So the root of Musa bulbosiana has natural medicinal properties. It's a natural antibiotic, and it has antioxidant and anti-diabetic activity. According to the Frontiers Pharmacy, the plantain banana has natural antibiotic properties, and it is an antioxidant and anti-diabetic. So this over here is a Venn diagram explaining what a niche actually is and the purpose of it. So in the yellow we've got the abiotic niche, the blue is the biotic interaction, and the red is the accessibility. So right in between the yellow and the blue, as you can see, that is the area representing appropriate combinations of abiotic and biotic conditions that make this crop suitable for potential distribution. Then, right in the middle, between the red, the yellow, and the blue, that is the actual geographic distribution. Abiotic and biotic factors are included in this. So this is actually all of these accessibility, abiotic niche, and the biotic interaction, all of these put together, that is what actually allows the species to grow within the environment. So what are the results that I found? If we look firstly at the bioplume current distribution as shown in the map above, this map represents the global distribution of the Musa babasiana, otherwise known as the wild banana, in the current global climate. The prediction is based on the bioclimatic model. The map represents the predicted surface distribution of the wild banana based on the current climate variables. The majority of the predicted surface distribution occurs in the regions close or at the equatorial belt. From the map, we see the distribution occurring mostly in Central Africa, large parts of South America, and quite importantly, across Southeast Asia. The map distribution classes range from excellent, very high, high, to not suitable, grey. The green represents areas that have medium to low suitability based on the input current climate variables. Noticeably, however, there are very few areas in the world which are suitable for the wild banana to grow. This is indicated by the presence of little to no red. On the other hand, there are distinctly more regions covered in yellow and orange, which represent areas characterized as very high suitability for the distribution of the wild banana, such as the Caribbean region, Equatorial Guinea, Gabon, northwestern border of Brazil, Vietnam, China, and Malaysia. It is clear to see that in the current climate, the plantain grows mostly along the tropical belt and in the tropical regions. There is a distinct relationship between the ocean currents and the areas in which the growth of the plantain is favorable. Whilst the plantain grows in the tropics and mostly along the coast where the warm equatorial waters flow, it also grows frequently in areas that have a warm ocean current, such as Central Africa and the coast of Southern Africa and the east coast of Madagascar, where the warm Angolan and warm Mozambican ocean currents flow. Growth is favorable along the bottom of the east coast of North America, Mexico, the east coast of Southern Africa, around Finland, Sweden, Norway, where the warm Norwegian ocean current flows, and in parts of Australia. It is especially favorable in Central Africa, South America, and in Southeast Asia. So if we look at the future distribution, the bioclimatic future distribution of the Musa babasiana, this map represents the global distribution of the Musa babasiana in the future climate. The prediction is based on the bioclimatic model. The map represents the predicted surface distribution of the wild banana based on the future climate variables. The majority of the predicted surface distribution occurs in regions close or at the equatorial belt. Much like the current climate distribution we see occurring mostly in Central Africa, large parts of South America, and quite importantly across Southeast Asia. However, more importantly, is the decrease in the distribution surface that is evident on the future climate. Although the difference is not obvious, upon closer regional analysis, one can spot a reduction in the predicted surface distribution in areas such as South America, Central Africa, and quite marginally in Southeast Asia. The majority of the change thus occurs in Brazil and Central Africa. This is a map representing the distribution of the plantain in a future climate in 2050. The map also shows the different climatic conditions for the plantain to grow and whether these conditions are optimal for growth. More popular in South America, one of the traditional dishes, become less suitable in South America and Africa. There's a marginal change in the suitability in Asia and Australia. Africa and South America remain having the most optimal conditions. Madagascar does dwindle a bit. It is not as great as it used to be, however the conditions are still quite favorable. And in the bioclimatic current for South Africa, you can see that it is covered by quite a bit of green, which shows that South Africa on the west coast where we have the warm agalas flowing. There you can see that these are areas that are quite good for the Musa bulbaciana to grow. There is very little light green and yellow that does appear and that does tend to appear in them. But conditions on the west coast of, on the east coast of South Africa are quite favorable. And we can see in the bioclimatic future distribution model, you can see that the conditions actually become a lot more favorable in the future. And this can be due to global warming causing, you know, South African landmass to warm up a bit more, creating more optimal conditions for it to grow around the area. So now let's look at the domain most limiting factors, the current domain most limiting factors. And as explained, we have seen the plantain enjoys the tropics and thrives, however, and thrives in these areas. But however, like in North Africa, it does not grow in areas where it is very hot and does not receive enough rainfall. Conversely, in Europe, it is too cold, yet it does receive a lot of rain. The plantain needs the tropics and good precipitation in order for it to grow optimally. In certain parts of South America, Central Africa, and Southeast Asia, there are times within the year, such as seasons, where there is not much rain received. They are known as the driest months. Coupled with the seasonal lower temperatures that occurs in the tropics, this causes the plantain to grow at a slower rate. Asia has one of the most favorable climates for the plantain and South America. However, Asia, as well as the Indonesian islands, suffer from seasonal periods where they receive a great amount of rain versus seasons with not as much rain. This is known as the monsoons. Here we have a look at the domain model, more specifically the domain most limiting factor model. This type of output shows the variables with the lowest score in each grid cell for which there is a prediction. The limiting factors represent environmental conditions, in this case climatic conditions, that limit the growth, distribution, or abundance of a particular organism. We are working with the wild banana. This concept is based on Liebig's law of the minimum. The different colors, there are 19 of them, represent different limiting factors or classes which may lead to the limited distribution of the wild banana. For instance, if you look at Siberia or Russia, the most limiting factor in that region which may lead to the limited distribution of the wild banana is the temperature annual range, indicated by the pink. It is likely that the annual temperature range is too small or limited and might not suit the climatic suitability of the wild banana across geographic space. This prediction is based on current climate and thus represents the current limiting factors which limit wild banana growth or distribution across the world. Similarly, in Africa, the most prominent limiting factor for the wild banana distribution appears to be limiting factors associated with precipitation, part in due to Africa being a generally dry and arid continent with one of the biggest arid deserts, the Sahara, in the world. So definitely you would not find the wild banana growing in areas like North Africa, and this is also the reason why the wild banana does not grow in the Western Cape, because it seems most of its rain during or on the west coast, because it receives most of its rain during winter, and the winter months in the Western Cape tend to be very cold. So the next model that we're going to look at is the domain most limiting factors in the future. So, with global warming occurring, this causes many parts of the tropical regions to have a significant increase in their maximum temperatures with decreased amount of precipitation. The decreased amount of precipitation and the warm temperatures may also cause the plantain to slow down in growth, wither or fail. What could exacerbate this is the slowing down of the global ocean currents. by bringing enough warmth and nutrients to the tropics. This above map does represent the most limiting factors for the growth and distribution of the wild banana in the future climate. From the previous map showing current climate, there isn't much noticeable or significant change. However, the increased appearance of red, this indicates the maximum temperature of the warmest month, both in northwest Africa and northwest Australia, speak to an increase in global temperatures in the future. So now let's look at the current domain on a true-false prediction. This map represents the global suitability map based on current climate. As has been explained, the plantain grows more favorably along the tropical belt where the most rain and sunshine is found and therefore grows mostly in South America, Central Africa, and Southeast Asia. The map is based on a distribution model using the out-of-domain true-false. There are only two possible values indicated on the map, i.e. suitable, 1 or red, or not suitable, 0 or gray. The purpose of this model is to simplify the representation of the geographic distribution in a binary form. So there's a true yes or false no. Due to all the domain models using the same algorithms, the data representation generally tends to be similar, just in different output types. As in this case, in the bioclimatic model, we get a picture of the predicted geographic distribution of the wild banana, which occurs in the same three regions, Central Africa, Northern South America, and Southeast Asia, all highlighted in red. The prediction is based on current climatic data. Importantly, a 95% cutoff was chosen for this analysis. So let's look at the future domain, true-false. Global suitability. This is a global suitability map based on the future climate. This shows a decreased favorability along the tropical belts of Africa, South Africa, and Southeast Asia. Based on the future climate, true-false prediction, it is evident from the map that there's a significant reduction and decrease in suitability and distribution of the wild banana in South America. This is indicated by the decreased red color. Interestingly, however, the distribution of the wild banana in Central Africa shifts in a northerly direction. Similarly to South America, there's also a stark decrease in red, this is the suitability, in Southeast Asia with little distribution that existed in Europe, virtually disappearing altogether. Below, we have a closer look at the various regions. So, this is the current domain for Southeast Asia, and this is a more regional analysis of the geographical suitability based on the true-false prediction. So you can see there are suitability in countries such as Thailand, Myanmar, Laos, and China, and also across Malaysia and Singapore. If you look at the following one, this is the future domain for 2050 in Southeast Asia, which shows a reduction in suitability. In the places that were mentioned before, Thailand, Myanmar, Laos, and China, and also a decrease in suitability across Malaysia and Singapore, all of the islands there within Indonesia, actually. If you look at Central Africa, there's little suitability in areas south of the equator, predominantly the Democratic Republic of Congo. And if you look at the future domain for Central Africa in 2050, there's an increased suitability north of the equator. So this is more towards the Central African Republic. This, as I said before, could be due to global warming. It could also be that the Earth systems have weakened, moving the warmth further up north. If you look at the current domain for Central South America, there are small patches in Central America and the Caribbean islands would show that they are suitable areas to grow, and they are also suitable areas in the northern expanse of South America or northern Brazil. This is the Amazon forest. If you look at the future domain, there is a significant decrease in the suitability in northern Brazil, the Amazon forest, of course, and this may coincide with the loss of biodiversity and terrestrial forest area within the Amazon. This is largely due to human activity, as we know that the Amazon has one of the most biodiversity in terms of species in the world, and it also provides the world with quite a hefty amount of oxygen. We receive that from the Amazon forest, but due to human greed and gain, the Amazon forest has been cleared, and that's in order to make things like paper, furniture, and as we can see in this future domain, the decrease in suitability of the Amazon basin is really due to human activity. So if we look at the current eco crop for the wild banana in the world, let me first explain to you what the eco crop model actually is. So the ecocrop model uses the physiological characteristics of a plant species to model the climate suitability of the crop. The model is widely used for global mapping of crop response to climate change. This against the background of the fact that increased temperature, dry and extreme rainfall have a negative effect on crop yield. The ecocrop works by evaluating on a monthly basis if there are suitable climate conditions within a growing season for the precipitation and temperature. The climate suitability of the resulting interaction between rainfall and temperature is calculated. The map above represents the eco-crop climate suitability of the wild banana based on the current climate data. As in all the other bioclimatic and domain models, the eco-crop model shows that regions associated with the tropical belt are the ideal areas for the wild banana to grow optimally. Based on the Köppen climate classification, the majority of suitable climate regions for the wild banana are found in the tropical rainforest climate and tropical savanna climate. These areas are more specifically include Central Africa, northern Brazil, the Amazon forest, and the Southeast Asian tropical region. All other areas colored gray represent non-suitable regions. So this is the Köppen climate classification, as was explained earlier on. And as you can see, the areas in blue, these areas are associated with suitable climate for the wild banana crop, which is along the tropical belt. So if we look at the eco-crop of future climate model, this is a map based on the eco-crop model of future climate data in 2050. So compared to the current climate eco-crop model, there is little to no significant change, albeit a slight increase in climate suitability in Central Africa. Below I have included a closer analysis of the three main regions. So in current Southeast Asia, you can see the main reason for the current climate suitability of the wild banana, the Gulf of Thailand and the Philippines. So the future of Southeast Asia, there's increased suitability, even though it is very little in India, and it remains the same for future climates to suitability in Thailand and the Philippines. If we look at the current eco-crop for Central Africa, the most important region for the wild banana distribution and crop growth, the main countries here are the Central African Republic, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Cameroon. So this is a very important area for the wild banana to grow, and it has got the most optimal conditions for the wild banana to grow. So the future ecocrop for Central Africa, as you can see, there's more red coverage indicating that there's increased climate suitability in Central Africa and the DRC. And there is a shift in regional climate suitability from the east coast of Tanzania and Mozambique in the more inland direction. Also, if you look at the current eco-crop map for Central Africa, Madagascar is there on the side, it's there in the corner. But as you can see, Madagascar has quite a favorable, because Madagascar is home to most species in the world. Most of the species are indigenous to Madagascar. It has got an incredible amount of biodiversity. So if you look at Madagascar in the current ecocrop model, you can see that they have a very favorable climatic conditions to support the wild banana. But if you look at the future ecocrop for Madagascar, you can see that there is a significant decrease in suitability. And this is largely due to the fact that a lot of the